The following year, in 1965, Martin Luther King and the SCLC and SNCC, now if we're still remembering who those groups are, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, this is the group of primarily Christian ministers that Martin Luther King was the head of, the organization that would often organize nonviolent protests. And of course, the SNCC, otherwise known as SNCC, this is the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. These two organizations got together to organize a march from Selma, Alabama to Montgomery. Now we jump from one troubled state to the other, from Mississippi to Alabama. It's always one of these two states that we are always hearing about this the most in. And the march was to protest the intentional denial of voting rights in the state of Alabama. Now, at first, Martin Luther King had talked with President Johnson trying to get him to pass a voting rights bill similar to the Civil Rights Act that he signed just the year before. Johnson was reluctant to do it because they had just passed the Civil Rights Act and felt it was a little too much too soon. Martin Luther King insisted that it was soon enough. If you want to see a very, very good film about what happens here, I highly recommend seeing the movie Selma. The movie does a wonderful job of depicting the events of this. Hopefully, you know, we'll watch that movie in our government class when you guys are seniors. But it focuses on this movement, the Selma campaign. The first time the protesters organized the march, they were met with violence. Members of local police, local marshals, a conglomeration of local law enforcement, basically attacked the protesters. These were peaceful protesters. They were knocked over the head with bats and bricks and whips, pulling them down like cattle. I mean, it was terrible. And everybody saw this on the TV. And so the following day, well, a couple of days later, there was this whole rush of people around the country coming down there because they'd seen this injustice on the TV. And they made another attempt. It also was stopped because King felt that violence may happen again. And so one more time, they tried again. And this time they crossed the famous John Pettus Bridge, which is kind of a halfway point between Selma and Montgomery. Montgomery, of course, being the capital of Alabama. And they marched all the way to Montgomery. And it wasn't soon after that that President Johnson did push for the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Now, it's the Voting Rights Act of 1965 that's been the subject lately of a lot of debate because there are very, very small elements of it that actually have been whittled away, making people kind of doubt how concrete this Voting Rights Act really is in modern-day America. However, at the time, in 1965, it banned things like literacy tests, and various other loopholes that many southern states use to prevent people from being able to vote. Prerequisites for being able to vote, like, you know, was your great-great-grandfather an actual citizen of the United States? Stuff like that. All kinds of really kind of silly and stupid and outright racist reasons that could be, you know, written into laws, reasons why you shouldn't be able to vote. All these things were eliminated by the Voting Rights Act. As a result, the voter registration amongst African Americans jumped dramatically. And you did see in a lot of southern states, black representatives being voted into either local legislatures, whether it be state or local municipal city legislatures, And you also had black leaders voted into national legislature, such as Congress, House of Representatives, the Senate. You had black governors and mayors within just a generation of when this was done. And all of this was made possible by the Voting Rights Act. Another thing that also happened was that African Americans could now sit on juries. And so now you had juries that were prosecuting crimes now made up of people from around the entire state, regardless of race. Very early on, a religious sect known as the Nation of Islam came to be a center for a lot of what we would consider the other side of the argument when it came to how to deal with the issues facing African Americans. And there were many within this organization that didn't want to integrate. They didn't want to be side by side with whites in schools or in other institutions. They essentially said, to hell with that. And they wanted to form their own independent, autonomous communities where they found themselves in various parts of the United States. The Nation of Islam was founded by a man by the name of Elijah Muhammad, who loosely based this movement upon a version of Islam. And he propagated the idea of what he called the New Negro, working to uplift impoverished blacks in cities and in downtrodden areas like Detroit and many other urban areas in the northern part of the United States. And one of the things that was very upsetting to people who argued against this side was how racist in turn Elijah Muhammad was towards whites. In fact, he often referred to white people as enemies or blue-eyed devils. And therefore, when there were concessions being offered by the official government, of course, at that time dominated by whites, they rejected it. They didn't see that as really being the answer. And this movement really got started on a large scale, starting in the 30s, moving throughout World War II, and then really picking up after World War II, kind of parallel to what we've been seeing happening in the South with what happened with Martin Luther King and the various other events that were happening along with him and his movement. This is what was happening in other parts of the country when it came to African Americans. Probably one of the most important members, one of the most important individuals to come out of the Nation of Islam, other than its founder, was a man who started out in the world known as Malcolm Little. Malcolm Little had been the son of a civil rights worker who was murdered by a mob of racist whites. For a while, he got caught up in drugs and crime, and he eventually found himself in prison. While he was in prison, he came in contact with a member of the Nation of Islam who taught him what Elijah Muhammad was talking about, his perspective, but also the basic precepts of the Muslim religion itself. This later would distinguish Malcolm Little from other members of the Nation of Islam. But in the meantime, not only did he accept the ideas, but he changed his name to Malcolm X. X came to represent the identity and heritage lost by Black Americans due to centuries of enslavement. In other words, it was a representation that African Americans had lost their heritage, that for many centuries in this country they were treated essentially as property with no last name, with no familial identity. And that's what Malcolm X was really hailing back to by changing his last name to this symbol X. Like his mentor, Malcolm X rejected the idea of integration, nonviolence, and actually called for African Americans to defend themselves. Malcolm X was quoted one time as saying, "When someone slaps you on the cheek, you don't turn the cheek and let him slap the other. You hit the other guy on his cheek and he'll stop slapping you." That's what Malcolm X was saying. And there were a lot of people in the North, in these northern cities, a lot of African Americans, who this is what you were hearing. I really encourage you at some point to look up Malcolm X on YouTube and listen to some of the interviews that were made with him. He was an extremely intelligent and intellectual in man, and the way he could elaborate his ideas was very unique and very wonderful to listen to. Malcolm X for a long time really was kind of seen as the alternative to Martin Luther King. In fact, Malcolm X actually visited Martin Luther King just before his march on Selma. In the meantime, however, starting in the mid-60s, Malcolm X started to dive a lot more into the actual religion of Islam. And he decided that, and he came to the realization that the organization, the Nation of Islam, and its member, he often referred to as the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, really wasn't following the true precepts of the Muslim religion. And therefore what he did was he did what a lot of traditional Muslims do. He went on what's called a Hajj, or a pilgrimage to Mecca in Saudi Arabia, where he went to the real source of Islam, and he realized that this religion preached a lot more peace and cooperation with their fellow man than what Elijah Muhammad was teaching back in the United States. When he returned to the United States, he changed his name yet again. This time referring himself as what you see here at the top of the slide, Al-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz. His wife also took that last name, Shabazz. And when he returned to the United States after this trip to Saudi Arabia, he really preached that people needed to work together. It wasn't quite so militant, quite so angry. And he began working for integration rather than against it. He began to turn his views much more towards something that resembled Martin Luther King versus what he learned in the Nation of Islam. He began to be very popular. He actually formed his own organization in the United States. And about a year after his return in New York City, members of the Nation of Islam, Black Muslim militants, marched into the place where his organization met, and they shot him about 15 times with shotguns. This has always been a hotly debated topic, because up until now, African Americans were being shot and killed. Leaders within the civil rights movement were being shot and killed by white supremacists, or, you know, members of the KKK, or just people who just didn't want things to change. Now, in this case, you actually had African Americans shooting someone, presumably, from their own organization. Malcolm X really, though, had stirred the emotions of a lot of African Americans who were growing impatient and growing tired with the nonviolent approach that Martin Luther King and the SCLC were taking. A member of SNCC, a man by the name of Stokely Carmichael, began to very firmly break away from the nonviolent approach that SNCC had for a long time followed in partnership with the SCLC and Martin Luther King. And he began to preach a message of what he called black nationalism, his own philosophy. And eventually it turned into something called the Black Power Movement. Carmichael and several other disgruntled SNCC leaders broke away from SNCC and they formed what became the Black Power Movement. And one of the ideas behind Black Power was this idea of militancy, self-reliance, independence, and nationalism, even within the confines of the United States. The problem with the Black Power Movement, from its very beginnings, was that people really weren't clear as to what they wanted or what they were protesting. It's very similar to the Black Lives Matter movement today. And that is, you have a slogan, you have a lot of emotion behind it, you have a lot of anger behind it, but what really is the objective? What do they want? What is it they want to correct? What is it they want more of? What problem within the United States is going to be solved through some kind of motive of social justice? And that kind of alienated a lot of people from the Black Power movement, as it alienated people from the Black Power movement. People started screaming, Black Power, Black Power, Black Power. But what exactly does that mean? Power to do what? The success of the civil rights movement up until this point was very much tied to the fact that their objectives were very clear. The segregation laws that were being maintained in so many of the southern states had to be torn down one at a time. And these marches were designed to do that. Now it was turning towards something that was very rhetoric based, very much a slogan, but people really weren't clear as to what it was all about. Now, out in California, a group of African Americans took the ideas of Stokely Carmichael and Malcolm X and actually coalesced them into an actual political party, and they became known as the Black Panther Party. These people brandished firearms. I had a friend of mine who is black. He grew up in South Los Angeles and he grew up right on Crenshaw Boulevard. His mother had a flower shop right on Crenshaw Boulevard during the 1991 LA riots. And he remembers growing up many years before that, and there was a white person who was threatening his mother, and a Black Panther person, complete with the black beret and leather jacket, and openly brandishing a .357 Magnum on his hip and a shotgun in his hand, and said, "Is there any problem?" The white person quickly decided that there was no problem. That was one of the things that they were able to do back then, that they could openly carry firearms. Black Panthers demanded the immediate equality of all blacks, including increased and fair employment opportunities, exemption from a military service in Vietnam, health care, and educational services. They wanted an equal share of everything. One of the big protests back then was that because you could get out of the draft and having to serve in Vietnam, we talked about that in the last unit, by showing you you could go to college. Well, a lot of African Americans at this time couldn't afford to do that, which meant they were often the ones that were serving in this very unpopular war as the 60s were drawing to a close. And so that was another thing that was being heavily protested at this time, was this kind of disproportionate representation of African Americans amongst those that were being drafted into the army during Vietnam. The Black Panthers very much protested that. Unfortunately, the Black Panthers became a target of the federal government, who discovered that not only were their leaders embezzling money, but they also had a connection to the Communist Party, which in April of 1968, while visiting Memphis, Tennessee, Martin Luther King Jr. was shot and killed by a high school dropout man by the name of James Earl Ray, who was seen running away from all the commotion and was arrested and thrown in jail. He was found guilty of the crime and spent the rest of his life in prison. King's assassination was unlike any other of those that had those public figures, members of the African American community that had a voice fighting for equality for African Americans. And the reason why it was so different was because when once King was gone, there really wasn't anybody to replace him. Martin Luther King's death proved to be one of three main reasons why the civil rights movement that had started with the Brown versus Board of Education decision in 54, Rosa Parks and the Montgomery bus boycott in 55, and then all of the iconic moments that happened afterwards. There was a number of reasons why the movement began to really fall apart. As we mentioned, first of all, there was King's death with really no one to replace him. Second of all, you had ideological shifts and feuds amongst the four main organizations. In other words, they were no longer seeing eye to eye as to how best to help African Americans throughout the United States. The NAACP, the SCLC, SNCC had basically fallen apart as a result of the splintering off of Stokely Carmichael with the Black Power movement. CORE soon ceased to exist. The Black Panther movement and the violent, more militant voices within the African-American community started to alienate people who had previously been sympathetic and been willing to work with African-Americans. The third, and actually interestingly enough, the least related incident was that by the time the late 1960s was rolling around, King was killed in 1968. By this time, people's attention was no longer on civil rights. It was on the worsening conditions of the Vietnam War. More and more bodies were coming home in steel coffins with American flags draped over them. And people were asking more and more about what this war was about rather than what was happening with African Americans. And so between King's death, the lack of unity between the main civil rights groups that had once come together in 1963 and that wonderful March on Washington, the I Have a Dream speech, that was now gone. And the focusing on the Vietnam War essentially spelled the end of this period of the American Civil Rights Movement.